cycle. And of course, we have a number of technologies that can potentially influence performance. So, drugs typically have been used, techniques which would include training, which is the baseline for much of the human performance modification done today. Machines, we're looking at a whole suite of things coming online from transcranial direct current stimulation, where you're running a current through the skull to affect brain activity, all the way through various types of imaging technologies and others, all the way down to the ability now to manipulate single neurons with pulses of laser light. And of course, this thing comes back to this question of why are you using these, or why might you use these? And the answer is to achieve some type of performance modification. But I think critically, we need to think it's not only about the individual, but also potentially across teams, and then of course across organizations. And when working at these different scales, you might actually modify people differently. You might learn that what would benefit an individual may not benefit a team, and of course so on and so forth. And critically, the timeline can be really broad. So you might think about a single incident, a battle. You might think about a longer period, training over months or years, all the way through a career. How do we keep someone in the fight? Would it be more valuable to have a 20-year-old who is enhanced in some way by 20%, or a 40-year-old with all the experience that he's gained or she's gained through their career, who can still perform at the level of a 20-year-old? And these are big and open questions. So again, why should we care about this field? Well, my favorite story, and this comes from Vietnam, I think it's rather instructive. So going into the Vietnam War, we were in the area of the missile, the air-to-air missile. And so the Air Force and the Navy had built the F-4 fighter even without an internal gun, because dogfights were sort of passe. And so we go into the Vietnam War, and in air combat over North Vietnam, both the Navy and the Air Force have an exchange ratio of about 2-1, meaning that we shoot down two of their fighters for every one we lose. And this was really quite a shock, both to the Navy and the Air Force, to the extent that they went back to the drawing board and tried to understand why this was happening. And this was about an N of 100, meaning about 100 kills from 1967 to 69. So this was not a fluke. And in that period, there's about a year break between 1969 and 1970, where during negotiations, we stopped bombing missions over North Vietnam. And so during that time, the Air Force has had a task force, and they're working to fix the missiles. They're saying the missiles aren't tracking properly, and this is why our performance isn't as good as it could be. And interestingly, the Navy starts off with the same question, but then in the famous ALT report, basically identifies that the key issue is, while the missiles aren't tracking that well, that really the pilots aren't using them properly. And so this leads to the creation of Top Gun. During this break in air combat operations over North Vietnam, the Navy is able to run a non-trivial proportion of its wings with at least two or more pilots through Top Gun, sends them forward, and the Air Force's modifications of the missile leave it at a 2-1 exchange ratio, and the Navy goes to 12.5-1. So that means that the training and enhancement to the humans in the system had almost an order of magnitude benefit to an actual operational and tactical performance. And I think what that shows is, the science, we often want better tools or better technologies, but we may overlook in many times the opportunity to enhance the human and gain tremendous benefits from that. I don't think we should forget that as we enter the era of drones and other things, that there's in many respects this feeling again that humans are outdated or being invalidated. And I think, again, that would be a huge mistake. On top of this, we see a number of technology trends in the security environment. So if you look on the x-axis on the bottom goes time, so rapid execution all the way through very long missions and continuous operations of everything from depots, warehouses and the such. And then on the y-axis on the left, you see complexity. And so humans are being really challenged to operate at even moderate complexity in very short timescales. So with certain types of cyber or hypersonic operations, you can imagine humans just can't react in thousandths of a second. And at very long time scales on the right, what you see is costs and limits to human endurance mean that multi-day or month operations or even continuous operations are challenges to the services today. And so those are real opportunities, for example, for autonomy and other things to benefit. But in the middle, what you see is sort of where you're getting to this very high levels of complexity, but at moderate timescales. And these are missions like coordinated strike and mine and IED clearance, where autonomous systems actually have tremendous challenges operating. While people like to talk about things like the Google car and others, actually the Google car isn't very autonomous at all. It just has exquisite maps. So it can't really tell if there's a stoplight somewhere. If the map tells it there's a stoplight there, it can tell you what color it is, but it really actually has tremendous challenges understanding the environment without those maps. So we're still rather far off from human-grade autonomous systems, and that means that humans at the timescales we can operate effectively still have provide tremendous benefits and have tremendous advantages. But that being said, as that environment gets more and more challenging, the opportunities and the benefits from enhancing humans, again, may provide huge benefits. And I'll talk more about that later. So this slide is entitled, Why Is Now Different? Whenever I give a brief on a topic where people have been saying that something's going to be revolutionary for the last 20 years, as people have been saying that this human performance technologies could change the world, and people have been saying this for a long time, if I don't tell you why I think now is different, then you shouldn't believe me. But I think now is different, and here's why. First of all, there's money flooding the field. A number of tools have been developed that have allowed us to really much more rapidly understand and manipulate biology, and the science is carried along with that, where we're learning things. On the bottom left there you see, this is a chart about epigenetics, meaning that your DNA, the letters in your DNA aren't the only thing influencing what happens in your cells in your body. Turns out that a chemical modification to proteins around it may be just as important as what's in the genes. And so these are things we didn't know. We had to learn and sequence the genome to really understand some of these things. But now that we know them, we're really understanding biology better. And as our understanding increases, our ability to influence it really increases as well. So talking about money and commercial incentives, right? So the majority of Americans are using supplements, and this is an enormous market, you know, several hundred billion dollars a year worldwide. And talking to entrepreneurs, investment bankers, people from Silicon Valley to New York City, there is widespread use of cognitive enhancement technologies, especially drugs, with no stigma. In fact, people brag about it. And, you know, in my work with companies and executives, there's a lot of interest in this stuff. And I think that's only going to grow as people understand that both it can benefit them, as well as the fact that, frankly, it's available. There's even now people essentially offering kits like to do transcranial brain stimulation over the internet. And so build, you know, do-it-yourself kits, because some of these technologies are fairly simple, although of course placing that right and making sure it's over the right part of your brain and making sure that the current isn't too high to cause damage is something that should give people pause before using a do-it-yourself kit. And so this isn't restricted to outside the military. This is data on the bottom from a survey of people in the Army several years ago. And what you see is not only do the majority of people in the Army and the majority of soldiers take supplements every week, what's really interesting if you look at those numbers is that, as you'd expect, there are fewer people taking 2 to 4 per week than 1 per week. But what's interesting is that there are more people taking 5 or more supplements a week than 2 to 4. And what that suggests is that there's a super user group out there. And anyone who's been involved with special operations community or certain other types of units knows that this is absolutely true and that there are people taking tons of things, even though essentially the Army provides them no support on what they should be taking or studies really on the potential benefits or negatives. So almost everyone's seen this graph. This is, you know, the plot of Moore's law, where both the transistor counts are growing at an exponential rate. And what's, I think, interesting and often perhaps overlooked about this, though, is that for the first 20 years of this, you see tremendous technological development. You know, there on this graph alone, you have three orders of magnitude more transistors on the chips in that period, but really minimal changes in people's everyday lives and for the military. However, in the next 20 years, with again, only let's say another couple orders of magnitude, this really changes the world, right? So we end up with, you know, in the military, precision strike, the boom in C4ISR technologies, and then of course the web and social media, and now eventually as we move to the Internet of Things. So I think what's really critical is, you know, people like to talk about nonlinear technology development, but what may be more important is that impact is nonlinear. And so now to come back to biology and human performance, many people have seen this. This is a sort of variant of what people refer to as the Carlson curve. This is the cost per genome. And so you can see it following even faster than Moore's law. But now let's plot this time scale to, you know, shrink it to a similar time scale. And what you can see is, you know, we're really only a fraction of this period up to this point, if you take gene sequencing development, of the way where Moore's law led to these tremendous advances. So now let's baseline it. And so if we start at 2003 with the end of the Human Genome Project, that would suggest that by 2023, the developments that will underpin really these huge effects will be in place. And that perhaps by 2043, really these revolutionary impacts will affect both the military and the world. So why do I think that the timescales for these two may be similar? Well, I think for one thing, the complexity of biology is substantially higher than it was for the engineering wing in computer science. However, we now have these computer tools to handle the complexity of biology more efficiently. So I think if you think about those as sort of a wash, we're now in a place where maybe those timelines are similar. And I think my forecast is that by 2043, these technologies will have at least as much impact on society as militaries as the internet and computers have today. And I think that's a reasonably strident forecast. You know, I see you have a little green bar there. I think it could be tremendously beneficial. Although, of course, as that flashes to red, you see, I think there's also potential challenges to the US as well. Just to give a little stronger forecast, the Human Genome Project really started in 1990. So if we start the 20-year ticker in 1990, this really may all come to fruition by 2030. So I'm going to predict then, or at least forecast, that between 2030 and 2043, so that people can hold me to this forecast later, that these technologies are going to reach the level of the impact of the internet today. So how might these impact us, and how might they impact the military? You know, so I think if you look at first selection, assessment, and alignment being where might a person both be best suited and maybe also enjoy their career the most. And I think the Air Force is really leading the way in thinking about moving away from a yes, no, whether someone can go into a unit, into really thinking about how you could put someone in the best spot for them. Here you have a diver. And I think what's really interesting here is that so there's research that shows that dissociation, so that moment under high stress when you might feel like time slows down or speeds up, you might feel like colors get duller or brighter, you might feel an out-of-body experience, that's dissociation. So the more you dissociate, the worse you perform in some of these tests in a special operations environment. And here you can see it's actually a really strong correlation. This is picking up over 45% of the variability in performance. That's unbelievable, really, if you look at the science in this area. And then also interestingly, this is not just a psychology thing. If you look at physiology, so now we're looking at post-stress DHEA, which is a steroid hormone precursor naturally occurring in the body. If you look at the association between those levels and dissociation, the higher levels of DHEA post-stress, the lower levels of dissociation. And if you take those together, that means that post-stress DHEA is correlated with performance pretty in a non-trivial way. And so, you know, research like this that's already been done is starting to help us think through what are the opportunities for both identifying people who would perform well under stress But also you can imagine thinking about where you might enhance people. So we're going to learn these things, and then we have the opportunity to use them as feedback and feed forward to enhancements. So this is some of the most striking data I've ever seen, collected by Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. They were in Afghanistan in the late 2000s doing research with Army units deployed far forward. And what they found was when they correlated the ratings of unit leaders at company level with PTSD symptomology rates, that leaders rated one standard deviation worse than the mean had people with three times the PTSD level that people did who were that leaders did who were rated one standard deviation above the mean. Now, this is potentially a correlation, but we have good reason to believe that this is causal. And the critical part about this is, if there's some influence of poor leadership, or at least a poor leadership environment, on things like developing PTSD, which obviously affects performance in a substantial way, and we can then figure out some of the underlying physiology behind that, then we have an objective way to measure, for example, leadership impact on units. And most importantly, not only can we then identify the better and worse leaders, but then we can test different training methodologies or enhancement methodologies to make those leaders who perform poorly perform better. Because even if you could just shift the poorly rated leaders into that highly rated leader category, you're talking about having the PTSD symptomology in groups, which I think any senior leader should jump at the chance to do. And yet, as best I can tell, no one has ever done anything with this data. We're also going to be able to then apply enhancements in a really tailored fashion. And so I talked earlier about the individual, the team, the organization, a moment across a career. We're also going to be able to individualize it. And so on the left, you see this is a photograph from Air Force research on transcranial direct current stimulation. And what they were able to demonstrate is that on a vigilance task, so that would be a task of sustained attention, you were able, people who had this transcranial stimulation were able to maintain their attention, whereas people with a placebo lost about 20% of their performance over 40 minutes. You can imagine the impact. Take an Army unit going through a long ride through enemy territory with potential IEDs. You can imagine that losing 20% of your ability to focus and pay attention could be potentially tremendously dangerous in terms of missing IEDs and injuries. So again, huge opportunities. And as we move forward, we're going to be able to do this in a much more tailored fashion. And this enhancement is going to be to human computer teams. So, you know, these two kids playing chess, in today's day and age, this doesn't really make sense, right? So one of these people should, or both should, be using a computer to back them up. What's really interesting is Garry Kasparov loses to Deep Blue, the IBM chess computer. And instead of saying, okay, well, computers can now beat humans at chess, he founds the field of advanced chess, or sometimes centaur chess. And what happens then is basically to say, well, then the highest form of chess is not a human versus a human or a computer versus a computer. What they realize is that the highest form of chess is a human and a computer versus a human and a computer. What they also find, which is perhaps most instructive, I think, going forward for the Army, is that the winners of the first tournaments are not grandmasters with computers. They're people who know how to use the computers well who are worse chess players. And what that suggests is, even though humans and the human brain are going to continue to be tremendously important, the training and the types of performance may be different going forward. And I think because of issues with comms denied environments, as well as just the ability of the human to make tremendously quick and complex decisions, there will also be humans on the battlefield. We're seeing exoskeleton technology very close to being ready to deploy in a military environment if one of the services chose to do so. And you can imagine that exoskeleton, depending on power needs and operational needs, also potentially can have computers in it that can help the human understand what's going on in a situation, provide information, and so on and so forth. And I think that brings up another point, which is, you know, I talked about three domains of performance: physical, cognitive, and socio-emotional, robotics really has the opportunity to decrease the challenges of the physical domain. We're seeing a big dog or an LS3 robot that can carry several hundred pounds for fairly long distances. We're seeing exoskeletons that now probably are pretty close to operational lives with energetic autonomy, meaning operating off battery lives for 2 or more hours without a recharge, that where you could, you know, let's say do bench presses of 200 pounds while it feels like about 12 pounds. So I think what we're seeing then is the true physical challenges are decreasing, but because autonomous systems and computers are still unable to really operate at this high end of cognitive and interaction socio-emotional states, those are still paramount. And I think that's really where we should be focusing and where the tremendously disruptive opportunities are. Now, that's not to say that the physical aspect isn't important. It just means over time, we're talking about, you know, the human dimension in 2040 or even 2030, or frankly, even in 2025, depending on where the investments go, that we should really focus, in my opinion, on the socio-emotional and cognitive domains. I think critically, though, right, the impact isn't just about technology. So the picture on the left is a German tank. Picture on the right is a French tank. We see a lot more pictures and talk a lot more about German tanks in World War II than we do French tanks. But what is fascinating is while the Germans used tanks and dive bombers, aircraft, and radios to tremendous effect in Blitzkrieg, the French had those technologies as well. And in some cases, they were more effective technologies, maybe even better tanks. But what happened is the Germans were able to synthesize these new technologies. They understood that to use them, you needed to mass them into armored units, whereas the French distributed their tanks throughout as sort of mobile artillery. And then they understood that you needed new organizational structures and CONOPs, right? So that was both the unit and then also how to use it. So organize the armored unit and then use it to drive through to the enemy's rear, cut their lines of communication, combining, you know, using the aircraft as mobile artillery, but only through coordination with radio was that possible. So again, this is, you know, when we talk about revolutions in military affairs, it's not only a new or a new use of a technology, but it's a technology plus a new concept of operations plus a new organizational structure that leads to truly revolutionary impacts. So then what are these plausible revolutions that we might see by 2040? And so this is my list of the top five that would both be that are both plausible and would really revolutionize the military. So right now it takes years to train and build cohesive units throughout a military. If you think about the investment of the U.S. military and our personnel, it's really tremendous and provides us a major advantage. But you could imagine if you were able to do that very rapidly, enhance the speed of learning through and cohesion, perhaps through some combination of brain stimulation, drugs, or other mechanisms, that if somebody could then, over a period of weeks or let's say a month, develop a cohesive and truly professional military, that would cause tremendous challenges to strategic warning. So you might look at a country and they might have a small military and you might decide you don't have to worry, and then suddenly they have 100,000 men and women force within a month. That would be a tremendous challenge to our intelligence community and to our military planners. And so again, that's not just about a technology to enhance learning or cohesion. It's also using it in a way that would have you be able to generate a force very rapidly going forward. And by the way, we have technologies today that already are able to enhance learning. And as we start to understand what unit cohesion is from a physiological level, it suggests methods that you might use to enhance. So second, enhance empathy for deception and influence. What we see is that in, for example, people with autism spectrum disorder, that they have the very tough time understanding why people do what they do. And this is called empathy in this community, or in the research community uses the term empathy or theory of mind, which is, again, understanding how someone's thinking and why they're doing what they do. Imagine if you could tremendously enhance that to the way that we wouldn't mirror image, we wouldn't think our adversaries think like we do. You could truly, in a sense, get into the mindset of your adversary. The impact on deception campaigns, the ability to do MISO or military information security operations would increase radically in a way that might change the way battlefield operates entirely. Of course, we go back to Clausewitz, war, you know, is politics by other means, but really at the end of the day, influencing the humans on the other side is what war is about. I think as we've seen quite critically in Afghanistan and Iraq, it's not been necessarily about killing or destroying enemy forces. Again, it's about influence. And even if we end up in a high-end military conflict, again, influencing our adversary's leadership will be critical to achieving our goals in that campaign. So again, this could, again, be a tremendous influencer on the future battlefield or future warfare. And again, at the same time, we see research into empathy, again, in the for treating autism, as well as the tremendous interest that's come up in sort of emotional intelligence and others and leadership studies over the last 20 years. So moving on to a third potential revolution, if you were able to take general purpose forces and enhance their performance to match that of special operations forces, that would, of course, be beneficial. But then if you were able to make smaller units with greater autonomy and decision-making, then you might get a revolution. Again, changing the way you fight to a more of a swarming approach, smaller units with more autonomy, so different organizational structure, different CONOPs, you might see a radical change on the battlefield. And what's interesting is we do understand some of the physiological differences between individuals who make it through special operations selection schools and people who don't. And so that suggests that those differences may provide a roadmap then to enhancement, or at least to selection when recruiting and other things. And so again, the current science provides suggestions that these are possible. And based on the trends analysis I showed earlier, I think by 2040, we're moving towards a place where these things are certainly possible. My fourth revolution, potential revolution, the name is a bit fraught because of some past Army work, but what I call it is operational planning based on human performance topography. And what I mean by topography here is, imagine instead of going after units or planning your operations based on where there are mountains and rivers or what the enemy forces equipment had, so you're going around air defense systems or around major armor formations. Imagine if the majority of planning was based on how good are the individuals, the people in those enemy forces. If we could know, for example, how likely is one unit to break versus another, even if they had better equipment and better position, you might choose to attack through that unit because you know that they're less likely to provide effective resistance. And so this would be I think, do use some of this today, again, certainly understanding where the enemy's premier forces are is taken into account. I think taking this down to a much more granular level and applying this much more heavily could potentially change the battlefield entirely and provide tremendous benefits. One of the things that I suggest also that plays into this is there will be more robotics on the battlefield, and there will also be people there. What that means, however, is that if there are fewer people because there are more robots, it means that each person is more important. And if each person is more important, then understanding the strengths and weaknesses of each of your adversary personnel, or at least units, again, becomes even more valuable. And then finally, there's been a lot of discussion of brain-to-brain communication or direct neural control of, let's say, UAV, where you would somehow use someone's brain signals to fly a plane, which, by the way, was demonstrated this year where they plugged a woman's brain into an F-35 simulator and she successfully flew it. But I think what would be much more interesting, because, to be fair, a human can already fly a plane, either remotely or in the cockpit fairly well, would be if you could use direct brain-to-brain communication for rapid innovation. So if I could come up with a new idea and you could almost instantaneously understand that in its depth what I really meant and iterate on that back and forth with me, it might provide a tremendous advantage in innovation. You might end up with order of magnitude or more improvements in creativity, that could lead to not only technological development, development of new concepts of operations, learning, and other things that would be tremendously impactful. So I think that in many ways could be the biggest effect of all, because it would enable so many other things. So those are really just sort of five potential revolutions I see by 2040. And again, the critical component of each one is in the cognitive or socio-emotional domain, especially when you consider support by robotics. And so I think going forward, again, this is really where the Army's focus should be. And these may sound a little bit crazy, being able to, you know, become a top performing soldier in a week or 2 weeks or a month. But I always like to say that when we call something art, it means we can describe it, but we can't explain it fully. When we call something science, we can explain it and describe it. And I think it's critical that something that's art today can become science tomorrow. And in many of these fields, this is already happening. I see researchers say things like, well, but we'll never understand human will. That will always be there and it will always be a critical factor, but we'll never be able to explain it. And that's scientifically untrue. So we already have insights into both the neurotransmission and the brain structures that are involved in will and willpower, and also how to influence them. So again, even researchers in the field sort of sometimes seem to miss where the advances are. And I think these are tremendous opportunities. But we will not lead by default. So this is actually a menu from an Army base. And I would tell you that this is not a menu designed to enhance soldier performance. So I think it's really critical to acknowledge, at least from my standpoint, that the Army is ignoring enormous opportunities ranging from nutrition to new learning methodologies going forward. And I think, again, for that reason and many others, the Army has major opportunities, but unless senior leadership decides that this is a priority, this will never move forward because it just doesn't have the same proponents that, for example, you have for a new armored vehicle. And I talked a lot about, you know, developmental timelines, and certainly microprocessors and others had tremendous private sector involvements, but the Army and the military in general will have a huge role in R&D if this is to happen. And so, you know, going back to the computing and Moore's Law example, of course, Department of Defense, DARPA, and others had a huge role in microprocessor and computing development, the development of the internet. And also in this case, it's really interesting is that civilian data may have limited validity to military operations. So in the middle there, these are physiological stress levels in various activities. And you see the green is baseline. You get a spike, let's say, for the first skydive, a public speaking test may even have a higher level. But then you see the Army SEER school is already a full, you know, 25% higher physiological levels and closer to the levels you'd see during open heart surgery than you would during these lab tests that people use in public speaking. And so I think what's really critical there is not only the fact that these levels are quantitatively and qualitatively different, but also SEER school may be multiple days and combat may be multiple weeks, months, or even years, whereas that laboratory public speaking test is a matter of 30 minutes or so. And so again, we end up in a situation where our environment may be not only more stressful, require different types of performance, but also have different timelines and work over different scales. So again, individual, team, all the way to the organizational level. So I argue that the Army should develop its own ethical enhancement program to drive both operational and ethical benefits. So people typically talk about this field as sort of ethically fraught, but I think really there's been a lot of lazy work done thinking about the ethics of human performance. There's some good examples of work. People might look at Patrick Lin's report from several years ago that's much more insightful, but I'm only going to touch on ethics here briefly because this is less about R&D strategy and more talking about the future of the field. But if you take the following case, I think it really highlights it. People say, well, but if you do the research, you might hurt someone. Well, I would tell you, you already mandate people to use body armor that weighs so much that almost all of your soldiers come back with injured backs or hips or knees. So you're already telling people, well, but it'll protect you, so we're going to do something that we almost certainly know will hurt your body. So if we're willing to do that there, then what is the difference between a physiological enhancement that in fact may not hurt you and may have tremendous benefits? With that body armor example, I would argue very little, but that the current analysis to date has really just been influenced by fear of repeating what were truly mistakes in the 1970s, where people were experimented on inappropriately and before the 70s by the US military and others. We shouldn't repeat those mistakes, but actually it's the case now that the US military is the most challenging place to do human performance research that I'm aware of in the US. In the academic setting, much easier. In the private corporate setting, much easier. So I would tell you that we're not only missing opportunities to research, we're missing opportunities to help people today. I have military personnel who come to my human performance consulting company because they're not getting support through their own units and they pay out of pocket for it, which frankly to me seems silly, but I do give them a discount. So a final thought before I take some questions, I always like to throw in a wild card at the end. If we had an effective read capable brain machine interface, so something that could read your thoughts, then I would say that almost anybody who's served in the military or the intelligence community could never use one of those for a future job where it would presumably provide you a tremendous advantage, because your brain is a classified computer and that would then be connecting your brain to the internet in a way or to computers. So suddenly recruiting would become really hard unless you could encrypt someone's brain so that that information couldn't be accessed, but I'm not letting someone try to encrypt my brain. So at the end of the day, these new technologies are going to pose challenges across the board, but I think there's huge opportunities, and I really want to stress that I think the Army has a huge opportunity today to catch this wave and make it militarily and soldier applicable in a way that could provide could put it at the forefront 10, 20 years from now. So with that, I'll thank the organizers at TRADOC, G2, and everyone else for letting me chat today and take some questions.
So, Andrew, before we move on, there was a question in the beginning of the chat like to put up front. The question was, if there are fewer humans on the battlefield, will this introduce psychological problems with battlefield isolation, or are there technological ways to enable soldiers to feel connected virtually, if not physically?
Absolutely. So this gets to some of these questions about unit cohesion. You know, I think this is a really interesting area because unit cohesion is something that people talk about as tremendously powerful and important, enabling soldiers to do things they couldn't otherwise do under tremendous amounts of stress. But you ask them, so what is it? They're like, well, it's the bonds between people. And so how does it work? And then the answer sort of trails off there, typically. And so, you know, again, if people are able to cognitively or physically do things that they otherwise could not do under stress, there must be a physiological mechanism. So there must be something going on that being around other people is changing. And we actually do see that. So if you put someone in a stressful situation with someone they trust, they have a lower physiological stress response to that. And so we do understand some of the physiology that may be operating here. And I think if we can understand that better, we'll be able to test what the extent to which virtual teammates, either than being actual computer avatars or your teammates there with you virtually, provide that same inoculation against isolation, or even directly inoculate people against that temporarily. And so I think we have fairly good opportunities to work through that problem. I think it's one that's real. And again, these are the complexities enabled by these new technologies or promoted by these new technologies. So I think what we'll want to do then going forward is test them and then use the same science that's being developed going forward to make sure that we don't think about these things in isolation. Obviously, something as complex as the human brain is something where we should really think about this holistically. Also, I see that there's a question that popped up about some of the work done earlier. I did want to highlight that work on, you know, under the slide saying psychology and physiology is not my work. That's work done by Andy Morgan, who's a researcher affiliated with Yale and various other places. And that's based on published literature. So I don't want to try and take credit for that. That's but really fantastic work and providing tremendous insights into the influence and markers in physiology on performance.
Andrew, if you check your private chat, there are three questions that are queued up for you from me, from other people that were participating. So if you could address those.
Sure. There was a question about further information about that PTSD and leadership. So that's data that was collected by Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. They send mental health advisory teams, so they call them these MHAT studies, M-H-A-T. And these mental health advisory teams went out and collected survey data on Army units at forward operating bases and beyond. I believe that data is from 2009, although it may be 2007. And what they found was that, you know, the best predictor or the best highest correlation between PTSD symptomology was not additional combat experiences beyond the first. And so what they found, though, was that these ratings of leadership were really profoundly had a very large influence on this correlation. And so I think we have some ideas about the fact that, you know, again, I said before that when you're with people you trust, you may have lower physiological stress responses. I think there's some reason to believe that high levels of stress or even moderate levels of stress over long periods of time, like a deployment, may make the brain more susceptible to PTSD. And if that's the case, then you could imagine that there's a reason that being in a poor unit environment caused by poor leadership could actually drive that. I've done a fair amount of work with Marine units and done interviews of people coming back from Afghanistan. And while that data is more anecdotal than it is quantitative, the descriptions were rather striking of what happened in units with different types of leadership. And then having had a chance to meet those leaders, it was even further striking. So I think there's a reason to believe that data is causal. And that's Army data itself. And yet, again, as best I can tell, nothing's been done further on that. So wait for any more questions.
Andrew, if you just look at the chat from Michael Jackson, there are a couple more questions in there for you.
I don't know if we're having technical difficulties. Oh, here we go. The question was, do I see these opportunities as a solution to meaningful human control of autonomous systems similar to the Centaur chess or advanced chess analogy I referenced? So I think to have meaningful human control of some of these systems, you're going to need humans in the loop, or on the loop, as we say. And humans on the battlefield are probably one type of solution to that problem that we're going to want to bring to bear. But to keep humans effectively on the battlefield, we may need to enhance them. And so I do think that these opportunities are a combination of, you know, robotics on the physical side, and then the cognitive and socio-emotional enhancements to handle the complexity of the operational environment. I do think that these are the real opportunities. And, you know, I think it's probably worthwhile to note that, you know, autonomy and human performance are flip sides of the same coin. If we, you know, we may use autonomy to enhance performance without humans, or we can use human performance enhancement to enhance performance in the same situation by keeping the humans there. And so I don't think that these things, though, have to be one or the other. I think you can use them together and probably get the greatest effect. Again, that chess example to me is rather striking. So I do think these technologies probably enable autonomy going forward. Certainly providing the brain to the robot, providing a human brain to the robot, as it were, by having the human there, is really exciting, powerful technology. that's, you know, that's one reason why things like exoskeletons and others that I've written on recently are exciting to me, because I still think for the next 20 years at least, and probably much, much further in the future, that the limits to autonomous systems are going to mean you're going to want humans in most combat environments. And so how do we enable the human across these cognitive, physical, and socio-emotional domains? Next question was, can we get a citation for the ethics report by Patrick Lin? So his name is Patrick Lin, L-I-N. And if you search Patrick Lin, Human Performance Ethics, and I believe it was funded by the Greenwald Foundation, or maybe mixing the name of the foundation up, you'll find it's actually posted on his website he teaches at a university in California. I think he teaches at Cal Poly. So we're waiting for any other questions.
If there are no more questions, I'll wait another minute, make sure no one else has a lingering question for you, and we'll wrap it up, sir.
Yeah, if you have a question and you don't have enough time to type it in, please go ahead and raise your hand and I'll recognize you and enable your audio. All right, Colonel Grubbs, I'm getting right back to you in just a second. Got to find you there.
Okay, I think I'm on. Mr. Herr, this is
there you go.
Lee Grubbs. Thank you for doing this today for TRADOC, and we have some great participation across the Army as I've looked at these names here, so it's been very helpful. I saw that recently, I believe it was an article you had written talking about a next-gen war game that had taken place. And you had talked about it. Do you feel like when you're in these locations with these thought leaders that the Army is properly represented? And can you give us some advice as the people working in this larger Army system on how we can make sure our voices are heard and that we're able to communicate requirements in a clearer manner? Over.
Sure. Can the crowd hear me again now?
Yes,
you're
sir.
Good.
We got you on.
Sure. So thanks for that question. You know, I've said a number of times that I think the Army has a lot of opportunities and that there's things that aren't happening. So first, I want to step back and say there are also tremendously productive and some really good work being done in the Army. And so I don't want to just smack the Army. I do want to say that there's a lot of good work being done in the Army research community. And also, I've had tremendously interesting discussions with TRADOC G2 over the last several months that led to this talk. And so, again, with their Mad Scientist Initiative, I've been really impressed by the breadth and the depth they're willing to get into in these questions and excited about the October conference. That being said, I think, again, that there are the thoughts are there and there's some research, but really I don't see a community that's pulling this across into application. And part of that is the rightful concern that in a political or public relations sense, that this is going to raise a lot of flags and ire. And so I think from my standpoint, senior leaders are going to need to get involved. And by senior, I mean 4 stars. I mean, political appointees, I think are really going to need to get involved to be able to take the Army to the next level in this area. And so, again, definitely some really thoughtful people in the Army, some good right work being done. But there's going to need to be a combination of top down and bottom up to make this happen. And so I think from my standpoint, a couple of things are critical. One, there needs to be a real hard look at the human as a critical component of these systems, which is already done. Obviously, the Army has a tremendous focus on soldiers, but really how things could be done radically better, what it might look like to have a radically enhanced human on the battlefield, and then understand from a very high level, both high level leadership and also strategic level, what would it take to field some of these technologies in the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years? And that probably means that Army leadership needs to be talking about it now. They need to be talking about it with Congress and others to make the case that, you know, from my standpoint, frankly, I think we have an ethical requirement to do some of these. So why would that be? If we have the ability to provide an enhancement that decreases the probability someone's injured or killed on the battlefield with fairly minimal effects, negative effects, or frankly, very safe technologies, then I think we should probably do it. Now, we need to demonstrate that it works in good research. We need to demonstrate that safety. But there are already technologies that I would suggest today are pretty close to reaching that level. And yet, I think if you talked about using them more widely, there would be tremendous concern from leadership. And so, again, I think that's a real stepping point. And then if you were able to have leadership buy-in, that would then trickle down to people at the more junior levels who are thinking about these and want to do that research, but frankly are instead forced into more incremental areas. So, again, I love what I see with the Army really focusing on this intellectually, TRADOC's work both now and going forward to October and beyond. So I'm really excited about that. And I think now is the time. As I said, now, I think now is different because we have this confluence of funding into the area from the private sector that we can leverage off of. We have these new tools, these advances in science that make now really a fantastic time to move on this topic.
There are two additional questions, questions 6 and 7 in your queue.
Sure. So question was regarding the data from Walter Reed Army Institute of Research, what are actionable steps I would recommend the Army take? Well, I think the first thing I would have done, certainly, especially before we removed our forces from Afghanistan, would have been to go in and to correlate those types of survey results with physiological data. You really have to see them at the same time to understand what's going on. And if, as I suggested, that one of these mechanisms may be that better leadership environments are able to decrease physiological stress levels over long periods of time, then you would be able to see that in samples of different units. And so if you then had that data, then you could probably randomly assign leaders to units, you know, at the beginning of a workup. So, you know, you would never want to change leaders right before people deployed, but you could essentially create a controlled experiment without causing major operational challenges that would have then allowed you to prove whether this was in case causal or whether it was just a correlation. And if you found that it was causal, then you would not only have that, but you would understand the physiological and some of the psychological mechanisms. And then you would have then you would understand what it meant physiologically to have unit cohesion. You would have an idea of whether some leaders were developing better cohesion and therefore enabling units to buffer against PTSD better. And then you could train those who were not doing as well. You develop training to remediate their leadership. Or for those who didn't successfully improve, you might not want to deploy them as leaders of units because they would make their troops susceptible. And oh, by the way, this isn't just about PTSD development, but you can imagine that people who have more PTSD symptomology aren't going to perform as well. So here you get the double benefit of performance improvement in an operational environment and decreased medical and mental health issues in the long term. So I think we're coming up towards the end of the time here. I really want to thank everyone for those questions. I know that the people at TRADOC generously offered to accept more questions via email or on the site. And if I have time or if I get those, I'll try to link up with people. But thanks for everyone for your time. I hope it was interesting. Look forward to continuing to develop this in the Army and really as it has the opportunity to take advantage of all the opportunities out there to help our soldiers.
Andrew, thank you so much for joining us today. We do look forward to seeing you at the Mad Scientist Conference in October. For everyone else listening in, a recording of this video will be posted to the TRADOC YouTube channel. I'll go ahead and send out a link to your emails, and hopefully you'll be able to download that and share it with anybody you would like to see. We also like to thank everyone else for joining. Also, please join us for our next speaker series on 8 September at 1100 Eastern Standard Time with Dr. Bruce West discussing the thought control of machines. Again, thanks everyone for joining, and thank you very much, Andrew.
Thanks again. Have a great day.